Greetings and welcome to Chapter 2 of the AESDirect video webinar series. In this section, we'll cover the Shipment Manager screen, and most importantly, I'll walk you through how to create an export filing. So the screen we're currently looking at is the first screen you'll see when you log in to the AESDirect system. It's your Shipment Manager screen, and you'll have multiple options for creating, editing, and deleting shipments. But for now, I'll show you how to create an export filing, and you can do that by selecting the green button here at the top of your screen. And now once we're in the export filing, the first thing I'll direct your attention to is this red asterisk on the right-hand side of the screen. That will denote a required field. Essentially, it's mandatory information, and you will not be able to proceed without providing that. Anything with a blue diamond is considered a conditional field, but it can become mandatory, all depending upon the mandatory information that you enter in the previous fields. Another item that can be useful to you as you go along is the informational icon next to the right of each field. If you hover your mouse over the information cursor, it'll pull up a detailed description of exactly what the field is looking for from you. So in our first box, you'll see email response address. You can add or remove as many email addresses as you would like. These are the email addresses that will receive the confirmation number. Also, these email addresses will receive notifications if there is an issue with the filing. Our next field is the shipment reference number. Now, this is just a number that you create for your own internal reference. It can be any number, any combination of numbers and letters up to 17. The only rule is that once you use a shipment reference number, it cannot be reused for future shipments. Next is our filing option, which is already pre-populated with pre-departure, so we will leave that as is. We'll scroll down to our mode of transport, and if you click in the field box, you'll see a host of options that you can select from. Our shipment today is going vessel, so we select option 11 for vessel containerized. Now it's asking us for a port of export. So one feature that I'd like to point out is the smart recognition that the system has. So our port of export is out of New York, New York. So if I type in NY, I see a list of all ports in the New York area. Port 1001 is New York, New York, and I select it. Next is the port of unlading, and that's going to be in Okinawa. And here is our departure date, and this is the date when the goods are scheduled to leave the port of export. The shipment is originating in New York. The country of destination is Japan. Next field we see is in bond typed. Since this is not a bonded shipment, we leave the pre-populated option of option 70, merchandise not shipped in bond. Associated with this in bond type field, our foreign trade zone and import entry number. Now these would only be used if you have a bonded shipment or an in-transit shipment. Since in this example we do not, we leave the fields blank. The original ITN field is neither mandatory nor conditional, but you would use it for any shipment that's been divided, replaced, or canceled. Then we see a series of questions at the bottom. Is this a routed transaction? And a routed export transaction is an export transaction where the foreign principal party in interest authorizes a U.S. forwarding or other agent to facilitate export of items from the United States. In this case, it is not, so we select no. Are the U.S. PPI and ultimate consignee companies related? So what that's asking is if the sender and the receiver of the goods, the companies, are related. In this case, they are not, so we select no. Does this shipment contain hazardous material? No. So that concludes Chapter 2. Please advance to Chapter 3, where we'll cover the party section information.